Today, we are honored to have with us Professor Jan Peter Balkenende, President of the International Advisory Board of the City of Rotterdam and former Prime Minister of the Netherlands. In this lecture, Professor Balkenende will share how good governance, complemented by an active civil society, forms a system of checks and balances which will enable sustainability in city development. Today's session will begin with a presentation by Professor Balkenende, followed by a discussion and Q&A session open to the audience, which will be moderated by Mr. Lee Tzu Yang, Chairman of the Esplanade Company Limited and a member of the CLC Advisory Board. With this, let us begin by inviting Professor Balkenende on stage. Professor, please.
Thank you very much for your introduction and also the right pronunciation of my name. Because I can imagine that the name Balkan is not so easy to pronounce. That happened to my brother. He lived here in Singapore, and you know that. And when he was in China in the 80s, together with another Dutchman, Mr. Duvekot, so Mr. Duvekot, Mr. Balkan, it was impossible for Chinese to pronounce, and they said Mr. Difficult and Mr. Broken Ankle. You did a fantastic job. Ladies and gentlemen, I love Singapore. I've been here many times, in the times when my brother lived here, I was here 4 times. I remember the first time we attended the Jurong Bird Park. And today we have the haze and a lot of rain. But when I was in the Jurong Bird Park, it was so hot. And my youngest brother said, it's better to be a tropical fish than a tropical bird. And we agreed with that. Ladies and gentlemen, it's good to be here to talk about cities, livable cities. And let me start by reflecting a bit on 3 experiences I had with some thinkers. People have views on society. The first man I would like to mention is Professor Benjamin Barber. I met him when I was Prime Minister, as a political scientist from the United States. And at the moment, Professor Barber is involved in a new initiative, a new organization that's called the Global Parliament of Mayors. And he has the conviction that it is necessary to talk in terms of the regional developments, the city developments. And he said mayors can make the difference. And of course, it's not only about the mayors, it's about developments at a local level, at a city level. And he says, if you want to change things in the world, we need indeed livable cities. That's the remark of Professor Barber. That's the first one. The second one is Parakan. Have you ever heard about Parakana? This is the usual reaction I receive. A few years ago, he was 33, he was an advisor of President Obama, and he is considered to be one of the most influential people in the world. When he was 33, he wrote a book with the title, How to Run the World. Isn't that great? You're 33, and you write a book with the title, How to Run the World. And his message is the following. He said, during the last centuries, in fact, it was all about the development of the nation states. Agreements between countries was the responsibility of nation states. Legislation, responsibility of the nation states. Financing things. And he says, at this moment, we can see there are a lot of issues that are above the level of the nation states. Climate change, security issues, energy, etc. So he says, instead of the role of the nation state, you will see the development of new alliances. Alliances between governments, businesses, NGOs, knowledge centers, etc. The world of new alliances. And at the same moment, he's referring to the role of cities. And also there you will find new alliances. And the third man I would like to mention is Peter Diamandis. He wrote, I think, a fantastic book with the title Abundance. And his message is the following. He says, there are so many issues on the world agenda. Poverty, hunger, illiteracy, human rights, health. And his analysis is that we have so many technical solutions. There's a lot of innovation. And his view is that, in fact, we do have the possibility to tackle all these issues, but we fail because of a lack of good governance. There are too many vested interests. Too many people are thinking old-fashioned ways about these developments. Ladies and gentlemen, if I bring together these 3 experiences, the idea of President Barber, the Global Parliament of Mayors, the idea of new alliances of Parakana, and the remarks of Peter Diamandis about good governance, I think we are in the midst of the world of cities. And I would like to make some remarks about livable cities. I do not have, I have a disappointment, I don't have a PowerPoint or a slides. Do you mind? There's no PowerPoint, so that, yeah, some people are disappointed. you don't have PowerPoints. What about your presentation? So I have to say something about the content of my speech, and it reminds me of a story. Maybe you've heard about the British television series, Yes Minister, Yes Prime Minister. You know the series, I see you, you recognize it. Maybe you remember that one program that the Prime Minister receives a draft text for his speech. And he read a text, and he reread a text, and then he said to his advisor, but it has no content. And then the advisor said, thank you for the compliment, Prime Minister. So I have to say something about the content of my speech. I would like to make 3 points this afternoon. In the first place, I would like to make some general remarks about livable cities. What's on our agenda? What's in our mind? Why are cities so important? The second question, that's a bit more to be specific, that's about Rotterdam, the Rotterdam experience. Also on the basis of my work as chair of the International Advisory Board of Rotterdam. And the third part of my lecture, my speech, will be about sustainability and the consequence of it. And then I'll try to bring together these three components. That's what I intend to do and draw some conclusions. Do you agree with these 3 points? Yes, it's okay? You're happy with it? Have I forgotten something? No? Okay. Thank you very much. This was the moment of interaction in my speech. First, about cities. Let's go back to earlier ages. What happened in the past? Let's go back to the 19th century. That was the time of the Industrial Revolution in the Western world. New factories, new organization of economic products, etc. That's what you could see. And after the Industrial Revolution, we had huge social issues. Poor people, the difference between labor and capital, a class struggle in many countries. That's what you could see. That happened in the 19th century. And then we got a huge financial crisis in the 30s, the Great Crash. And then people, after the Second World War, said, this should never happen again. And it was a time when economists like Keynes, John Maynard Keynes, said, we can change the economic behavior. We have to correct economic developments. Governments have to play the right role. And that was the start of the new thinking about the role of governments in society. In England, we had Lord Beveridge, and he spoke about the social guarantees for people. In my country, we had a committee van Rijn, that's also with comparable ideas. What can the state do to create a better life for people, and how to avoid the risks of the 30s? In the Western world, we spoke about the role of the welfare state. I studied economic and social history and law in the 70s and beginning of the 80s. When I was a student, I learned about what are the instruments of the government, planning, regulation, financing. And the political scientists talked about the facilities of the government. In fact, it was all state-oriented. And in fact, it was oriented on the nation-state. That happened in the 70s. In the 80s, suddenly people discovered that if this government, is the state, is playing a big role, a too big role, it can jeopardize economic well-being. It can jeopardize the role of market parties, companies. And then suddenly we got Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, and we talked about supply-side economics, neoclassical views, and the government was not the solution but the problem. And then suddenly it was about the shareholders. Then it changed in the 80s. And then, 10 years later, suddenly people said, oh, wait a moment, it's not only a matter of the working of the market. Then we had a fantastic book of Francis Fukuyama. Maybe you remember the book. You know, Francis Fukuyama was well known in one, only because of one paper. You know the title? The End of History. And he said we can see the breakdown of the communist regimes in Central and Eastern Europe, the breakdown of the apartheid regime in South Africa. Dictators had to leave their work in South America. He said there's only one organization of society that's called the liberal democracy. And it's also market-oriented society. But he went on studying, and then he wrote a book with the title Trust. And then he said, if trust does not exist in a society, you get difficulties. High trust societies, high trust companies are performing better than low trust societies. And he said, you have organized in the right way. So the fact of trust was very important. And the other one was that people talked in terms of the role of institutions, institutional economics. And what about today? Today we talk about quality of life. And we discover that the old views, Keynesian approaches, neoclassical approaches, institutional theories, in fact have to be replaced partly by a new view on organizing things in society. And I think that's also the explanation why there's so much attention for the role of cities today. You can see it worldwide. People talk about quality of life and how can you improve quality of life in the life of people themselves. And that's the reason why people are focusing on the role of cities and how can they improve quality of life for people. Having said that, there's also another development. And you have to combine it with this component. At this moment, we're talking about concepts of like the next economy and the next city. And you know what the next economy means. The next economy means an economy that is really influenced by new developments like robotics, 3D printing, nanotechnology, the Internet of Things. It has also a moral category. The next economy is about sharing, a sharing economy. Can you use things together? So there's a new relationship between ownership and using of products. And in fact, it's fascinating to see that people are talking about the concept of the next economy. And the question are these developments of the next economy relevant for the development of cities? And I think that's the case. Therefore, people are also talking about the concept of the next city. And the next city is about improving quality of life in cities. It's about how can you stimulate the awareness and responsibility of groups in society, NGOs, etc. Can you use bottom-up approaches? And more people are talking in terms of strengthening the quality of life in cities by taking benefit of the knowledge of people, giving room for social projects, for creativity. It's also about the startups. That's what you can see at the moment worldwide. A fascinating world of next economy and the next city. That's what you can see. And that brings me to your center, Liveable Cities. I think people do not accept when they have to wait too long. For example, in a city like Rotterdam, if people have to wait too long for an allowance of the government to act, they say, okay, we don't use subsidies, we start by ourselves. People are talking about regulation. Let's say if you have startups, sometimes they are blocked by the current patterns of regulation. So the startups say, please rethink your ways of regulating things. That's what you can see. So livable cities are about creativity, are about the bottom-up strategies, are about startups, are about the new view on the economy, the sharing economy, etc. That's what you can see. And also people are not satisfied when the air is polluted, when you have to live in an area that's dangerous. You can see it in a city like Beijing. I've been there many times. I've been there when it had rained and suddenly you could see the sky. The sky was blue and you could see the mountains. If you're there for 2 or 3 days, everything is back and then you can see the air is so polluted. Our oceans are filled up with plastic, the plastic soup, you know what it is. So people do not accept to live in an area where it's dangerous, where it's not secure, where the environment is polluted. And that's also part of livable cities. So it's about having jobs, room for startups, quality of life. All these things are components of the livable cities. And I think it's fascinating to talk about these elements. It's necessary. And that brings me to my second point. When I'm enthusiastic, I realize maybe I speak too quickly. So if you have complaints, just raise your finger. Okay, I will go on. Second point. My experience in a city like Rotterdam. Who of you have attended the Netherlands? There is room for some improvement. And who of you has attended Rotterdam? Okay. If you compare Dutch cities, the ones of you who have attended Amsterdam, you know Amsterdam is in fact our golden age. If you are walking there on the canals, you will see the beautiful houses, the canal houses. And in fact, that had to do with the richness of the 17th century, our golden age. And we have beautiful museums, the Rijksmuseum, we have the Night Watch, a beautiful painting of Rembrandt van Rijn, the Van Gogh Museum, the City Museum. Amsterdam is the city of the creative industry, the financial center, the South X. We have Schiphol Airport. That is, in fact, Amsterdam. It's very popular among tourists. The second city I would like to mention is The Hague. We consider The Hague as the legal capital of the world. You will find 150 legal institutions, court of justice, etc. It's the place of our ministries, our embassies. Yesterday we had the start of a parliamentary season, then the king gave a speech on behalf of the government. That's the start in the Hall of Knights. A beautiful city, but typically it has to do with legal issues, with the center of politics, of embassies and ministries. That's The Hague. And then Rotterdam. The ones of you who know a bit more about the Netherlands know that the city has been bombed during the Second World War. So the whole city center disappeared. So that meant that after the Second World War, we had to rebuild the city. A kind of laboratory for architects. So the city was in fact modern in the 50s and the 60s. But you can imagine what is modern in the 60s is not modern at all in the 80s and 90s. And the interesting thing of Rotterdam is that it's a city that's reinventing itself constantly. It's a city at the river. It's a city with a huge port. When I was a kid, then Rotterdam was the biggest port in the world. That time is over. It's now about China and Singapore, etc. But still, it's the biggest port, and it will continue to be so, the biggest port in Europe. But the city disappeared. So what happened in the 50s and 60s is they had to rebuild the city. But in the 80s and 90s, people said, we have to reinvent ourselves. We have to strengthen the profile of the city. And then during the last 20 years, you could see the skyline has changed completely. New buildings, new architectures. And that's what I like to mention. You can see if you have new building activities, it also leads to another atmosphere. Let me give an example. I think it's now about 20 years ago, we realized the Erasmus Bridge that connects some parts of the city. When that bridge was realized, suddenly other parts of Rotterdam became very interesting. You could see the theaters, the restaurants, some parts. In fact, it was not popular among people at all. And now suddenly families want to live over there. So only having that new bridge created a lot of opportunities. Central Station area. 8 or 9 years ago, when you would attend the Central Station of Rotterdam, it was a no-go area. Dangerous. Drug trafficking, etc. And now we have a new Central Station, and now it's a hotspot. People want to be there. You have new apartment buildings, you have offices, you have shops. The whole area has changed completely. And last year we had a new building, it's called the Market Hall. It's an apartment building, but the interior is indeed a market hall with all kinds of food stalls, etc. And the roof of that market hall, the interior, is a big painting. Attracted attention in the New York Times, etc. So people are coming to Rotterdam just to visit the market hall. You attended the new Maasvlakte, the extension of the port of Rotterdam. So the coastline of the Netherlands has changed because of the extension of our port. I'm mentioning these developments to underline the fact that Rotterdam is reinventing itself, and suddenly you can see that quality of life went up. And today Rotterdam is a very popular place. I'm also a professor at Erasmus University. I'm teaching at the law faculty and the economic faculty. I think in the economic faculty have 10 or 11% more students last year. Students want to work and live in Rotterdam. We have more and more students. Foreign companies want to be active in a city like Rotterdam. If you ever would have the chance to have a presentation of Dan Rozengaarde, I clearly could recommend to visit one of his meetings, because Dan Rozengaarde is a designer, a young entrepreneur. He has fantastic ideas. But let me give some examples. Maybe you know a bit about the Dutch. We have a saying, usually people say, ja maar, yes but. I have a new, yes but. I want to earn, yes but. And he developed a chair. If you want to sit, if you sit on such a chair and you say yes, but, then you get an electric shock. He also saw that if you are using some elements, components, pieces of art, it will change the behavior of people. Let me give an example. Sometimes we have these terrible tunnels under railways and the railway stations. He developed an object with all kind of pipes, and at the end of the pipe you will find a small light. And if you walk along that object, suddenly the lights are starting and there's music. There's a technical dimension. But what happens when people are walking along that object, they start talking with each other. So it will lead to another behavior of people. That's the good thing of Dan Rozengaar. A few months ago, he had a project in Amsterdam. And as I already described, we are a country below sea level, so we have to protect ourselves. And the question is always, if we would not protect ourselves in the Netherlands, what might happen? And he had a project with blue light on Museum Square in Amsterdam. And then you could see how high the level would be of the water if we would not protect ourselves. So there was a kind of blue light 2 or 3 meters above you. In the beginning, there were 2,000 people. And the local authority said, you only can have 2,500 people to watch it. The third evening, there were 60 or 70,000 people just to want to see it. That's Dan Rozengaard. I think it's a great man. And the fact that a man like Dan Rozengaard has a new studio now in Rotterdam says something about the city. I learned from all these experiences that you can change a city when there's the willingness to change things, to do other things. And that's also the reason why when I was invited to become chair of the International Advisory Board, I said, that's good to do that. And what I noticed when we had the meetings with people in Rotterdam, there is so much vitality. We also have people from Singapore who are member of the board. Dr. Tan from Temasek, he has been member of the board. Aka Peng, she also has been member of the board during the last years. And if you would ask the people, of the members of the International Advisory Board, what are the most interesting components in the program, they will say the meeting with projects in Rotterdam. Young people with their culture projects, social projects, environmental projects, economic projects. You can learn so much from these young guys with their dreams, their ideals. And the good thing is that the local authorities are taking up these initiatives, these bottom-up initiatives. Talking about a city like Rotterdam, it is about creativity. It's about talking on issues like sustainability. What can you do with an issue like sustainability? The Port of Rotterdam, I already mentioned it. They have a strategy that's called Rotterdam Port 2030. And they want to be a sustainable port. Their criteria are stricter than other ports in Europe. And now people from Singapore and Brazil are coming to Rotterdam just to learn more about the concept of a sustainable port. That's what you can see. What we also can see is the local production of energy and food. I think it's also here on the agenda. I think we have new concepts around local production of food and energy, and it's very interesting. I mentioned the book of Peter Diamandis, Abundance. He says if you would have 4 or 5 big apartment buildings in New York, and you would use the new agriculture techniques, it would be enough to feed the people in New York. This is the type of insights we have more and more. So, talking about Rotterdam, it is indeed about the next economy, the next city. It's about doing the right things for society. It's about bottom-up strategies. It's about, in effect, about everything. And that's, I think, the reason why people are so enthusiastic about Rotterdam developments. A city that knows that you have to reinvent yourself constantly. If you are happy about the results of the past, that's not enough. A real entrepreneur always will innovate. Because if there's no innovation, you can forget it. And maybe that's the combination of the work of your center and the work of the International Advisory Board of Rotterdam. I brought with me a brochure. It's a brochure of your center, and that was the cooperation between the Shell Company and the Center for Livable Cities. And I really like this this brochure because it is about the new world of cities. And when you read the document, you will see the issue about the outcomes, the what's. And then your center say it's about high quality of life. I have also made these remarks. It's about a competitive economy. And it's about sustainable environment. That is what you should realize. And then the question is, how can it be realized? And then you will see issues like think long-term, fight productively, build in some flexibility, execute effectively, innovate systematically. And that has to do with dynamic urban governance, lead with vision and pragmatism, build a culture of integrity, cultivate sound institutions, involve the community as shareholders, as stakeholders, and work with markets. I think it's a fantastic insights, and we need this type of orientation. That brings me to our last report of the International Advisory Board of Rotterdam. We said, if you want to speak about a city like Rotterdam, what should be on our agenda? And then we said there are five dimensions: governance, good governance, making city, realizing all the different developments, social development and responsibility, sustainability, and support the next economy. And then we said there are the following themes are the general things. The first thing we say, you have to connect networks. Sometimes you have networks of schools, universities, you have networks of companies, you have the governmental organizations. Try to connect these networks. That's the first message. The second is, dare to experiment. Give room for experiments. Let me give an example. I was in a car, an old car, and the man was constantly smoking and was an ex-criminal. He's been in jail. He has seen the bad side of society. And when he left jail, he said, I only want to do one thing. I want to convince young people that they have to work on a better quality of life, and in any case, they should avoid that they will go to prison. He knows the language of the people, and he is doing the right things because he says to young people, you must have the training, try to get a job, be honest, don't steal. And I think we should have room for these experiments, dare to experiment. The third one is transparency and accessibility of the system. And the last one is storytelling and communication. It always helps when you have a nice story to tell, because it can convince people. It's about dreams. It's about realizing new developments. So these, I think there's clearly a connection between the work of your center and what we try to do as the International Advisory Board of Rotterdam. And that brings me to my third point, my last point. And that's the issue of sustainability. Who of you have seen the film of Al Gore, An Inconvenient Truth? It attracted a lot of attention. It was about the climate change issues. And let me give one small example. In the film, you can see pictures of the Alps in Europe 100 years ago and now. And when you compare the pictures of 100 years ago, now you will see that a lot of these ice caps have melted, totally or partly. That was 100 years and now. And I've seen also another film. There's a film that's called Chasing Ice. And it's a film about a cameraman who installed cameras in Iceland, Greenland, and Alaska. And every month he made a picture. And when you put these pictures behind each other, then you get a film. And that's the reason why the film has the title Chasing Ice. And then you can, and that's, that was not 100 years ago, and now it's between 2006 and 2009. And you can see pieces of ice as big as Manhattan, but twice or three times as high, disappeared only in 3 years' time. That's what you can see. You can see what's happening with the North Pole. Less ice. People are really worried about everything. We talk about the world temperature. It's getting higher and higher. And we try to get it at least not more than 2% higher, but at this moment we can think it will be 4 or 5% degrees. So it's a risky affair. We have to be aware of the fact that we have 9 billion people in 2050. Scarcity of natural resources, climate change issues, and one thing is clear, we cannot go on, we cannot continue the current production and consumption styles because we have big difficulties in the future. And that's the reason why we have to rethink our way of producing, our way of consuming, etc. There's also the connection with the next economy, the next city. And I think things are changing. You have heard about Milton Friedman, the famous management guru. In 1970, he said, the business of business is business. You have to do it in the right way, in a polite way, you have to respect the rule of law, etc., but that's it. And today, we have Michael Porter, also a management guru from Harvard Business School, and he says, no, it's about creating shared value. A company is there to generate economic value, but at the same moment, you have to generate social value by addressing the needs of society. That's one element, creating shared value. The second one is about the idea to have new alliances. I already said something about it. Companies cannot act alone. If you want to act, you need others. Let me give an example, Unilever. Well, you all know Unilever. I think it's a very interesting company. They've integrated sustainability into their business model. They have a strategy that's called Sustainable Living Plan. When they had their first year evaluation, that was not an internal Unilever event, no. It was an event with all the partners in the value chain, but also other companies were invited, NGOs were invited, government officials, and people from the academic world. Choose for a stakeholder approach. So we will see more and more new alliances. You cannot act alone, you need to work together with others. That's essential. And the third point is, have more focus on the long term. We've seen in 2008 what the consequences can be of short-term focus on making profit. What we've seen in the financial crisis is we had all kinds of stimuli, bonus systems, all kinds of facilities in order to be very successful in the short run. And if you fail with having a long-term focus, then you get difficulties. And more people are saying, take into account the issue of the long-term. When I was in Japan, I spoke with a lot of companies over there, and what kept me busy is that they were talking about what are the values of our corporation. And many companies use sustainability as a value. And then I asked, why do you have these values? Well, that has to do with, let's say, the family character of many businesses. You can see it over there. I think the issue of value is very important. And of course, you can say to me, well, Jan Peter, but the discussion about CSR is there for decades. Yeah, that's true. The discussion about CSR has been there for decades, but something has changed. First thing is the discussion about growth. In the 70s, we had a Club of Rome, and the message was limits to growth. I think today we say growth is part of human nature. A sportsman wants to reach the gold medal at the Olympic Games. A researcher wants to realize the best research results. An entrepreneur wants to discover new markets. So growth is a part of human nature, but not at all costs. So it must be sustainable growth. Let me give an example. Ray Anderson, he was the founder of a carpet industry in the United States. He started in the 70s, he was very successful. Every year the turnover was higher. Profits increased. And after 20 years, he received an invitation to give a speech about his economic success. And that was the moment when he started reflecting. He said, okay, it's true. My profits went up all the time. I'm very successful. But have I ever asked myself how I've reached those profits? Have I been thinking about my CO2 emissions? Have I been thinking about energy efficiency or probably even the renewables? What about labor conditions for people in the third world? What about the fair treatment of my workers? All these issues. And that was the moment when he said we have to integrate all these components in our business model and our business strategy. That's what you can see. When I started working at EY, people said, oh, that's nice, you've been prime minister, what you're doing now? I said, I'm partner at EY. Oh, what are you doing? I'm partner corporate responsibility. And the American said, ah, that's great. We do a lot in the sphere of corporate responsibility. And my question was, what are you doing? And the answer was, we give money to charity. And of course, there's nothing wrong with giving money to charity, to cancer research, hospitals, museums. But the fundamental question is, how have you reached your profits? That's the issue. So the issue of growth has changed. When we talk about sustainability, the question is how can it influence, how can it change your business model and your business strategy? Are you integrating those components in your business model? The third one is the business case. There has been a time the attention for sustainability increased when the economy went up, and when there was an economic slowdown, the attention faded away. That was a traditional situation. And now more and more you can see that you can see the opposite. It is possible to be profitable by choosing for sustainability. First, Eccles of Harvard Business School, he made a comparison between 90 what he called high sustainability companies and 90 low sustainability companies between 1993 and 2010. And the outcome was that the high sustainability companies had a higher rate on return on investment, a better position on the stock market, and better reputation than the low sustainability ones. It's very interesting. And there is enough proof that it is possible to change things if you have the willingness to rethink your business model. It is possible. And the last component is, if you say we choose for sustainability, it must be an honest story, and that's about measurement and reporting. I'm working in the world of auditors. The auditors will have another task and responsibility in the future. Now it's about delivering assurance on the financial performance of a company. In the future, it will be about integrated reporting. It's not only about the financial performance, but also about the socio-ecological performance of a company and the integration of both of them. That means also an accountant, an auditor, needs a more holistic approach. That's what you can see. And of course, in my country, all the big companies, they are involved in it. The family office, the family businesses, more than 90%, and I can imagine that, because that family businesses are connected with society and have a long-term orientation. SME is a bit lower, it's about 60%, and of course much more can be done and must be done. But I'm convinced that we have to change things. Companies have to rethink their business strategies, their business models. That's, and it's necessary. And I think, and that brings me to the end of my remarks, there is a connection between the view on the future of cities, the Rotterdam experiences, and the world of sustainability. There has been a time when we tried to split up everything. You had economic researchers for the economic issue. You had social scientists for the social issues. The environmentalists for the ecological things. And today we know you must have a kind of holistic approach. What's happening in the world of energy is relevant for climate change issue. And what's happening in the field of climate change is relevant for migration issues in the world. All these issues are connected. That's the point. And if you want to do business today, it's also about your role in society. That means it's not only being active as an entrepreneur in traditional sense. No, it is about choosing for quality of life. And therefore, you can see a new relationship between governments, universities, and businesses. In the time when I studied, we had a kind of left-wing approach. Profit was a kind of dirty word in left-wing political circles in my country. That time has changed completely. We need business. If you would speak with, if you talk with Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of the United Nations, he said we will never reach the development goals and sustainable development goals without the private sector. We need each other. That's what you can see. We are in the process of transition, and therefore it's so important that we are working together, that we are redefining strategies. So the concept of the next economy, the next city, livable cities, the role of businesses, it's in fact these all are related items, related themes. And of course, we have to speed up developments. I believe in human nature, I believe in the inventions, I believe in the fact that people can be very innovative. Also, I'm aware of the risks and the fact sometimes it's not going fast enough. Of course, I know that. But I'm convinced that if you are choosing for the integration of sustainability in our concept of cities and businesses, universities, that will lead to the changes. It's remarkable that students in the Netherlands, they ask from the professors, directors of universities, to integrate sustainability into the curricula. That's their demand. What I notice is that young people, when they want to have a job at companies, they also ask, what is your sustainability strategy? And otherwise, they will choose for another company. You have to be practical. And the ambassador, of course, always said, be practical, talk about cycling. Isn't it, Mr. Ambassador? So I've forgotten that, but also when we talk about livable cities, you have to improve the quality of cycling. So you need separate cycle lanes, etc. It would be fantastic if you would have more separate cycle lanes here in Singapore. Maybe it's a bit wet today, but in any case, it's important to talk about other forms also of transportation. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we are living in a fascinating world. I mentioned Dan Rozengaard as an example of a young entrepreneur with his views and ideals. You see new leaders like Paul Pom of Unilever and all the others, they are very inspiring. We need a source of inspiration for the future. I think that's key. And that gives hope to all of us. I think that's really fantastic. It's great to be in Singapore. You can say, can consider me as a friend of Singapore, not only because of the fact that my brother lived here, he married a Singaporean, I had my experience in this beautiful country. I still remember the song, We Are Singapore, in the 80s. I remember it. It's really fantastic. I think Mr. Lee Kuan Yew played such an important role. If you see how Singapore was 50 years ago and how it's now, that was really a symbol of leadership. I think it's, you can see it. And I had the honor to meet him a few years ago when I had a Temasek conference. It was great to be seated beside him. I was honored and I admire what Lee Kuan Yew has reached here. Ladies and gentlemen, I started with some books, and as a professor, I should also end with referring to a book. You need some consistency in your speech. And the last book I would like to mention is a beautiful book that's called Why Nations Fail. Maybe you've heard about it. Why Nations Fail is a book of two professors, one from Harvard and one from MIT, Otsumoglu and Robinson. And they've done, for 50 years research, that's about 3,000 years world history. And their key question was, under which conditions can countries be successful or not? That was the key question. And their answer is threefold. First is, if you want to be successful, you always must have the willingness to innovate. And there must be the room for disruptive change and with creative destruction. You must also stop with some activities. If there's no innovation, you can forget it. Second component is rule of law. No corruption, integrity, transparency, all these things, the rule of law. And the third component is you must have inclusive institutions, meaning that people must be able to share in the revenues of growth. Because if the revenues are only disappearing in the pockets of communist or capitalist elites, and people don't have the possibility to share in those revenues, then you also get difficulties. That has to do with fairness. And I think these remarks of the author of this book, Why Nations Fail, are extremely important. You can learn from it. And if you would ask me who's a man who inspired you, and I would usually I'm referring to Mahatma Gandhi, the great Indian leader. He always was convinced by the importance of ideas. And he said, if you have a new idea, in the beginning they will ignore you. And then they will laugh about you. And then they will fight you, and in the long run you will win. So he believes in the power of ideas. And I think the next economy, the next city has to do with those new ideas. And he also made another remark, and I think it was a very important one. Once he said, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. And I think that's a great remark, and it's exactly what we need in this century. Thank you for your attention.
Good afternoon, and thank you for that tour of the horizon, which was really quite inspirational. Before opening it up to questions from the floor, perhaps, may I say that the Netherlands and Singapore have certain similarities in terms of being small countries surrounded. There's a strong historical connection, of course, and we owe many aspects of our development to Dutch advisors. You refer very much to Rotterdam, and I have seen Rotterdam, and I've seen the changes that have happened in Rotterdam. To what would you attribute what was the tipping point that made those changes possible? And what was the role of governance in that?
I think the tipping point in Rotterdam was the time when people suddenly realized that everything was new after the Second World War, but suddenly it was old-fashioned. People realized that the quality of buildings was not enough. People realized that there must be a more business-friendly atmosphere. People realized that you had to invest in the quality of life in the city, and suddenly people started talking about how to attract investors. People started talking about realizing the Erasmus Bridge and all the other activities. We also discovered that it's important to talk about sustainability issues. I think this process started about 20 years ago. And at this moment, we have a fantastic mayor of Rotterdam. He has a Moroccan background, and he is playing a fantastic role. He's really uniting people, and he's honest. So the combination of economic opportunities, sustainable port development, the willingness to attract investors, to improve quality of life, these dimensions made, I think, the big difference in Rotterdam. And that's the reason why I think at this moment Rotterdam is doing well. And of course we have our difficulties, that's true, we're not there. But in any case, we've seen the progress.
We have indeed hosted visitors from Rotterdam, and I think it's been quite a story to understand. Okay, if I could maybe invite the audience, if you could come up to the microphones and perhaps give your name, identify yourself, and ask the first questions of Professor Balkenende, please.
Thank you for the presentation. It was really very interesting. My name is Peter Stones. I'm from ARUP, which is a company of civil and structural engineers. My question is around generally the issue of sustainability. And I guess the crux of my question is, do you think currently we really truly understand sustainability as an issue? And sort of to go back to one of the examples you made earlier of the bridge in Rotterdam forming this new connection and the sort of the surprising impact that that had on spreading or creating the livable city on both sides of the river. Do you think that we currently really understand the impacts of our own actions and how it can improve or harm the livability of our cities? And what do you think we need to do to enhance our understanding, and where do you think we are along that sort of the process?
That's a great question. How much time do I have? Because you're completely right. The question is sustainability really an issue? What do we really mean by that? In the Netherlands, we've had a time that people talked about sustainability issues, but it was not really in the heart and minds of people. It was something extra. In the 70s, I remember very well when he did the report of Club of Rome, Limits to Growth. It was very popular in left-wing circles, but it was not mainstream. And today, it has changed completely, because if you talk about climate change, it's about us. It's not left or right, it's in the interest of everyone. That has really changed. So it's not a left issue, it's an issue for everyone. So that's the first thing. The second point is awareness. You know, the Netherlands is a country for more than one third is below sea level. So we constantly know that we have to protect ourselves against the strength of the water. And if you're not investing in the dikes and dunes, etc., then you will have terrible consequences. We've seen that in my country in 1953, 1800 people were killed, but died because of the water flood. So there's a kind of awareness that there is a connection between the issue of climate change, the rise of the sea level, the melting of the ice caps, with our own existence. So the awareness has changed. The third one is leadership. What I notice is if you have the right leaders, they can be very inspirational. Paul Polman of Unilever, he's seen the poverty in Africa with his own eyes. Vegas Siebesma of DSM, he is really aware of the risks of what might happen with our planet if the temperature will increase and increase. And those leaders said, this is not only an analysis of what's happening. No, the question is, what can we do? What does it mean for our company? So a man like Paul Polman, he said, within 4 or 5 years, that's the business goal, we want to double our turnover. At the same moment, we want to reduce our carbon footprint by half. That's really a challenge. It's about creativity. And what I notice now more and more is that people are discovering that you can do things in another way. Maybe the people from the Netherlands know there's the device that's called a waka waka. You've heard about it? A waka waka is a solar powered device, so you can get light. If we would be able to replace the kerosene lamps in third world countries by these solar powered lamps, it will save lives of millions of people. Every year, millions of people die because of kerosene in the slums and the cities in the world. A company, and the Waka Waka is a startup, a small company that's producing it, but also a company like Philips, they're active, of course, in Africa. They are busy with doing things another way and busy with other lighting systems. Another element is, we should be careful with the natural resources. That's the issue of the circular economy. And we know that if we think in terms of the circular economy, it can be very beneficial. It's necessary from an ethical point of view, but also you have economic opportunities. So I think it is a matter of analyzing things. It's about talking about your dreams. It's about taking action. And that really can make the difference. It's also about honesty. It's about honesty. If you are setting your sustainability targets, do it not alone, but have also stakeholder dialogues. Therefore, you need people from the academic world and NGOs. That's going to be helpful. So I think the combination of all these elements, awareness, analyzing things, talking about your own business strategy and how you can change it, These things can make the difference. And the last point, I think more and more people are convinced that we are running out of time. The longer we wait, the more difficult the steps will be in the future. That's what you can see. So therefore, it's better to work together. And therefore, I'm very concerned that what we should do at the moment, we should make a success of the Sustainable Development Goals. We should make a success of the climate summit in Paris this year. It's necessary. But at the same moment, you can see what's happening geopolitical, the problems of Russia and Ukraine, the Islamic State, etc. And of course, these developments are there, and I'm very worried about it. But at the same moment, we have to work to have a better world, and we have to tackle the issue of sustainability. And that's, in fact, your remark.
If I can maybe follow. Oh, okay. Gentleman in the middle.
Hi, I'm Quek from a marine company, an offshore marine company. I have two questions. One is about the Rotterdam port. I understand your name is Smart Port. And what can we take away? 3 points that you feel we yet to implement where it's very good for Singapore. Second question, front three row, they are your CEO sitting in front of you now. How you convince them to embark on the sustainability or integrated report?
Great questions. First about the Rotterdam port and what are probably lessons of Rotterdam for Singapore. First element I would like to mention is the development of the right criteria for port development in the sphere of sustainability. The criteria of Rotterdam, for example, entering trucks, etc., are higher than in other ports in Europe. And in the beginning I thought, oh, maybe that can jeopardize your competitiveness. But you've seen the opposite. People admire Rotterdam because they are honest about the goal to become a sustainable port. And now it attracts attention. So try to do your utmost to be a sustainable port also in developing the right criteria. That's one. The second point, that was very interesting. When we have new developments in the Netherlands, you always have these procedures, legal procedures. People can oppose. People can bring in their arguments for the court, etc. And if you have these legal procedures, that can take a long time. And good thing of Rotterdam is they understood the fact that if you would have so many legal procedures, you have to try to avoid them. And what happened? The port of Rotterdam, they had an excellent communication with other cities, with NGOs, with civil society organizations, and a willingness to find the right solutions. And I think that was a great achievement in the Dutch context, just by communicating in the right way. I'm not aware, of course, of the situation here in Singapore, but in any case, in the Netherlands, that was an important one. And the third component I would like to mention, that is the cooperation between the port and startups. The current CEO of the Port of Rotterdam, Allard Kastelein, he worked for Shell for a long time, he was an environmental specialist. He personally is really involved in attracting those startups in the port. And we have a new program that's called the Port Innovation Accelerator. So the Port of Rotterdam does everything to stimulate startups to be active in the sphere of port development. I think it's really great. So you have the connection between a big organization like the Port of Rotterdam and those startups. I think it's a really fantastic idea. That about the three elements of the Port of Rotterdam. And then your second remark that has to do with the role of CEOs. I'm also chair, as I probably said, of the Dutch Sustainable Growth Coalition. That's a coalition of 8 multinationals who've all integrated sustainability into their business models. And our second report, and you can see it on internet, you can download it. The second report was about leadership and corporate governance aspects. How can you embed the thinking about sustainable growth business models into your organization? And in fact, you need a lot of elements. You must have the right tone at the top. That's the work of the CEO and the others. But it's not only, let's say, the executive members of the board, also you need the non-executive members of the board. Are they only talking about the financial performance of a company, or are they also talking about the sustainability performance of a company? You need a non-executive member of the board. Another element is ownership within your own organization. It's not only the top, also the others must be involved in it. It's about transparency, the willingness to report about it. It's about remuneration systems. For example, the AkzoNobel company, it's a chemical company, number one on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index. They have a remuneration system in which people receive bonuses when AkzoNobel has a high position on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index. So you can also use financial stimuli to do it. So there is clearly a role for the leads of companies. And I think it is about developing new insights. It's about honesty. It's about societal involvement. It's about clarity. So if you talk about sustainability, you must be able to show it's not only a vague idea. You must be able to lay the connection between sustainability and what does it mean for your organization, your products. Let me give an example of my company. I'm working at an audit firm and tax advisor firm. If you'd ask me, what does sustainability mean for your organization? Of course, you must have sustainable buildings and new mobility programs. And of course, you're sponsoring the Dutch Olympic Committee. That's all okay. But in my company, the core business is not using buildings. The core business is the work of our auditors, the work of our tax advisors, our task specialists, and our consultants. So in our company, sustainability means, will the role of auditors change towards integrated reporting? The tax advisors, are they involved in issues around paying fair tax? The transaction specialists, how do you define the value of a company? Is it only about your goodwill, your products, your R&D activities? Or do you also include the sustainability issue? And when you talk about your advisors, we have bought a new company, so we have extra advisors in the sphere of sustainability. When you talk about the university, you can have beautiful ideas about sustainability, but if it has no relevance for the research programs and the educational schemes, then it's not the right story. And what we try to do in the Digital Growth Coalition is to say, what is your core business? What can you do about it? Let me give some examples. DSM is a chemical company. They are receiving prize of the United Nations because of their contribution to the work of the World Food Program, nutrients, etc. AkzoNobel, I mentioned that company, they are producing coatings. For example, they produce coatings for ships that makes it much easier to clean the ships, and you can have a higher speed with a less amount of energy because it makes these ships much more effective. So there's a connection between sustainability and the way you're producing coatings. I refer to Heineken, the local sourcing. 60% of the grains needed for production of beer in Africa must be produced locally. Less transport, less amount of environmental pressure, and more opportunities for the local farmers. Friesland Campina, a dairy producing company. They are active here in Asia. For example, they have microfinance projects in Indonesia. I can give many examples. The questions, are you willing to talk about your products? What can you do? And I think the CEO can be a source of inspiration to say, we will change things. For example, the CEO of the Port of Rotterdam, he said, no, we must have a sustainable port. We will attract the startups. So I think the role of CEOs can be enormous. But it's not only about the CEO, it's about his whole organization. If Unilever, and has an extremely well positioned at the moment in the sphere of sustainability, if Paul Polman would leave Unilever, of course, the story must not be over. So it's also the responsibility of the CEO to embed it within his own organization. I think that's all necessary. So a lot of work has to be done. We are not there, of course, but it's very good that you underlined the role of CEOs because it's necessary. It's true.
Professor, you've spent some time talking about the role of companies and CEOs. What do you think about governments? I mean, you've been in that position yourself. I think one of the differences between the Netherlands and Singapore is that Singapore has basically had one government. Netherlands has had a succession of coalitions, and you have been actually very successful in putting together different coalitions. What's the role of government in making this happen?
I think the role of government, you cannot compare the role of the government here in Singapore with the Dutch government. It's another situation. But there are some common elements. I think governments are there always for regulation. Sometimes if you talk about rule of law, you must have civil law, etc. Transparency, so the government can do a lot in that sphere, regulation. The second is, sometimes there are a lot of developments that cannot be organized by the private sector because these are the early inventors, etc. It's too expensive for. So you can also stimulate those developments that cannot be realized via the market, in pharmaceuticals, etc. And the third one, I would like to underline that, a government is also a partner in a network of relations, and that's what you can see more and more. And I was speaking about the cities in the Netherlands. We have a model that's called Triple Helix, that the governments and knowledge centers like universities and business are working together. We have that experience in the Wageningen area, that's what we call Food Valley, Agriculture University, it's a fantastic university. We have Energy Valley in Groningen, that's the gas producing area in the Netherlands. Governments, universities, business are working together. We have consumer electronics in the Eindhoven area, Philips and other companies. We have port development in Rotterdam. So governments can stimulate those type of activities by working together with others, that it can really be helpful. So we need governments, and especially in the relation with others. In the time when I was minister, I shared the innovation platform, and then we said we have to do much more in the sphere of innovation, so the governments can do, but we also said innovation platform is not only a government body, it was also a body of and some ministers and high-ranked people from the business sector and people from universities. I think these are the roles for the governments, and we need them, of course. That's true.
Gentlemen behind, just behind the pillar, could you please bring the...
Sir Balkenende, thank you very much for your insights. My name is Nigel Goh. I'm from the UNDP. In your introductory remarks, you alluded to the importance of cities vis-a-vis nation states. Nation states have a platform in the United Nations to discuss issues, to have agendas and so on. So my first question is, are there equivalent platforms, or is it useful to have equivalent platforms for cities? The second question relates to sustainability. Is there a role, an enhanced role for cities compared to governments, nation states, in this? Because at the moment, the dialogue appears to be at the national level, or companies and so on, or centers like CLC. So appreciate your comments on these things.
Yeah, two great questions. Thank you very much for that. And it's also fantastic that you're here with your responsibility for UNDP. I know your organization. First question is about the relationship between cities and nation states. And of course, you're completely right. The United Nations is a institution of nation states. And I must say, I'm very happy we have the United Nations, because we need a forum internationally. And of course, you always can talk about how does it function and how can it be improved, but you need an organization in which nations are working together. And I will not say we won't have nation states, but you can see the role of nation states is changing. And let me give then a comparison with what I noticed when I attended the climate summit in Copenhagen in 2009. Everyone was watching the heads of government in Copenhagen. And when I arrived in Copenhagen, I asked my minister for environment, what's happening here? And she was really disappointed. It was only about abusing the procedure of the United Nations to block decision making. That was one. The second was that the president of China, the prime minister of China, he said, we will do a lot in the sphere of sustainability, but not on the basis of international binding agreements. And President Obama, in fact, he was blocked by US Congress. So we were disappointed. And then I thought, if you would have again such a summit, prepare it in the right way, do it timely. But my lesson was also, it's not only a responsibility for national governments, you need others. And that was the reason why, when we talk about, let's say, the summit in Paris, I always underline the role of the private sector that counts for the business sector and the NGOs. I'm on your side when we talk about sustainable development goals. We need them. But there's one big risk. You can have beautiful defined goals, but it is about implementation. What will be the follow-up? And when we talk about the follow-up of the sustainable development goals, we need businesses, we need NGOs, but we also need cities. I'm sure about that. So I really hope that the discussion about SDGs will also lead to commitment of the private sector and also the role of regions and cities. I think it's essential. And let's start from the beginning with talking about implementation, because it's not so difficult to develop and to define goals. But the question is, what are you really doing with it? That's the point. So we mustn't have a kind of struggle between nation states and cities. That's not the case. But be clear in what cities and regions can do, how they can contribute. And what you can see at, let's say, not the level of a nation state, but at the level of cities, sometimes people are more practical because it's about the quality of life in life and companies of every day. So I think there are a lot of opportunities. And then your second question that had to do with the role of cities and sustainability, I think I made already some remarks about that. Sometimes, of course, you need national criteria. When we talk about tax policy measures, that's a national item. If you talk about transparency of companies, for example, that's a directive of the European Union, then you need the European institutions. You know, the integrated reporting, we will have a rule that's called comply or explain. I think that's good because it's a stimulus that companies are open about their sustainability results. So you need also the supranational level for the right forms of regulation. You need also nation states. But at the same moment, it's also a responsibility of cities, and especially when cities are working together with others. I really am hopeful because people in cities, mayors and others, understand that if you want to improve quality of life, as I said, you cannot act alone, you need others. I've been a member of my city council for 16 years, so I know what it is. I had a great time. And why was it a great time? Because you were working together with people in society itself and on a practical level. And that's what you can see worldwide at the moment. People want to take practical steps, and therefore you need a level of cities. So it's not, it's or whether it's a matter or it's a nation state or it's a city, that's not the point, but you have to be clear in your implementation strategy, and that's the reason why you need the city so much. So I really hope this year that when we talk about the sustainable development goals of the United Nations that will be discussed in September in New York, and when we have the climate summit in Paris, that the element of implementation will be high on the agenda and also be clear about the actors that can be relevant for that.
Perhaps wearing my CLC hat, I can add something to that. There are several forums developing for cities and for mayors. There's a well-known one called C40, where cities have come together to try and share their learnings and work together. You see this breaking out in different parts of the world, in parts of the United States, even in China. Cities are coming together to try and do things together. On our part in CLC, we have run now for, is it three, four? city summits for mayor's forums, where we bring together mayors from different cities, basically to encourage the creation of fora for mayors to work together. Indeed, the ones that I've met are very close to what's happening in their city. I mean, they see this as their responsibility. In a way, there's a bit of a tussle, perhaps, between the city and the nation, because they're always fighting for their share of tax revenues and so on. But they're very close to the issues of the city. Do we have other questions? Cycling? That's been growing in Singapore, by the way. From a position, perhaps, even 5 years ago when it was deemed to be impossible, it's now becoming a lot easier, partly due to infrastructure, but I think also partly due to public attitudes.
Talking about cycling, and I have to do it because of our ambassador. In my country and in many countries, you can see new development that's called the e-bikes. So there's cycling and you have the assistance of some electric equipment. And you can see the following in the Netherlands. Sometimes the distance between the house of a pupil and the school is a bit big, so then they need a bus or something else. Now, because of this technical means, people can use those e-bikes. That's one. The second point is that the elderly in my country, many of them are using these e-bikes. So the interesting thing is that you can see new behavior of people because of these new opportunities, new possibilities of the of cycling. I think it's really great. But also you have to take into account the conditions. Cycling is nice, but if you don't have separate cycling lanes, then it's a dangerous affair. I was always also in favor of having cycles and bicycles in New York. But if you have the streets and the avenues and there are no separate lanes, well, I would say don't do it. But also that's changing. So that's what I noticed over there. So there must be the willingness to do things in another way. So we will see what will happen here in Singapore.
I would say the attitudes are also important. I mean, in the Netherlands, the cyclist is king. The cyclist is more important than the pedestrian, and more important than the motorist.
Yeah, and sometimes there are many legal protections for cyclists. So if there's an accident between a cyclist and a car, you always lose as a car driver. And sometimes I have the impression, well, is this not going too far? Because when I'm driving my car, I don't have a driver anymore, so I have to drive by myself. And when I see a cyclist just using his mobile phone, sending SMS or something like that, and he's just hitting me, then still I'm responsible. So maybe we could discuss another time.
No, it's defensive driving. Other questions? Yes, Excellency.
Thank you. Actually, I wanted to thank you for the bicycle part of the story as well, Professor Balkan. And indeed, I think it's important to raise the awareness on bicycles. But actually, I want to ask you a question, Mr. Lee, if I may, on the subject matter of today, of what Professor Balkan explained to us, and on how companies and Dutch important multinational companies, including Shell, a company that you know pretty well, are integrating sustainability in the business models and including in the supply chains, and maybe it's a little bit short, but are putting stakeholder value before shareholder value. What is your experience here in Singapore? To what extent is this happening in Singapore, and to what extent do you believe that Singaporean companies would be receptive to this way of thinking and way of working? In other words, how do we put the message across to the extent that it has not happened yet?
My view is that it's a long haul. There's no shortcut on this one. I mean, Professor Balkenende is actually correct when he says sustainability begins at home. So you have to know your own business, and you have to know the cost of your own business in a total sense. Not just the money costs, but also what it costs are in terms of the total bottom line, you know, in terms of carbon emissions and so on. Part of the challenge in operating in Singapore is that you have to buy a lot of things. And so upstream, you don't really manufacture upstream. So you have to track, in a way, the carbon footprint of things that you buy. So unless there is actually standards which you can look at in order to enforce on your procurement process, how do you actually get that? So in a way, the multinationals are in a better position because typically they are globally networked, they have global procurement processes, they have a lot of muscle, they can ask for things, and generally they can get them. If you're a small company in Singapore and you're trying to run sustainably, part of your challenge is you have to know the footprint of what you're buying, not just how you make it. And that's a real challenge because it's really a life cycle challenge.
Maybe I can make an additional remark, but that is about the issue of education. Because if you talk about livable cities, sustainability is also a matter of mindset. And you have to start with it not only on university or something like that, you have to do it in, let's say, what's happening at home. It's also part of education. It was a beautiful example I witnessed in Rotterdam. That was a primary school. And what happened with that school, during the holidays and the summer, they renovated the school and it became a green school, a sustainable school with solar panels, energy efficiency, etc. That was a technical dimension. And the director of the school said this must not only be a technical issue, the renovation of the school, it must also be an educational project. So when school started again, the teachers explained to pupils why they had a longer holiday this year. And then they asked, what do you see here in the school? Oh, we see solar panels, etc. And then they explained why they had this new sustainable equipment at the school. And then the next question was, does this concept of the school, a sustainable school, does it also have meaning for yourself and your behavior? And then they started talking with the pupils about using water, etc. And when I came at a school, all the kids could explain me what a definition of sustainability, and also they could explain what this means for them in their own families, etc. So that's one dimension. The other one about education. A company like Unilever is busy with reducing water because it's a key issue and worldwide. And if you are informing your clients and also the kids, that can really be helpful. So the issue of education, we need it. And especially at the local level, you can make the difference. I'm sure about that.
So if I may add to that, I think the attitudes are changing, but what we need is good science, and we do need standards. We do need international standards, which you know people can subscribe to and believe in and have confidence in.
Yeah. Talking about science, we have an initiative in the Netherlands that's called the Groene Zaak, Green Business. That's a cooperation of, I think, now 160 companies, but of course more will be there. And that organization also started with a new initiative, it's Green Brains, and that is an initiative of research from universities who are working together in order to find solutions, sustainable solutions. I think it's a fantastic initiative because you are uniting, you are encouraging the cooperation between research from different universities, and they are very practical. So if there's an issue, you ask the group of specialists, what can you do about it? I think it's very, very good. So also in the sphere of research, we have to do the right things. Also, I know that also Randstad is active here in Singapore. And the founder of Randstad, Mr. Goldsmeding, he is very interested in the relationship between ethics and economics. And he is supporting new initiatives in my country to develop new ideas for economists, to develop new views, insights, theories, and also do other research projects. So I think all this type of initiative really can make a change, can make a difference.
There's a gentleman in the middle again. Mr. Quek.
I just wish to share with our Mr. Ambassador here. What situation in Singapore is an industry perspective. Those who know SGX, you look at the number of companies 400 over, how many people do the either sustainability or GRI, those who are familiar, 3.2, 4.0, or so-called iReport or this thing. From there, you can see the number is very low. I think from, you're not mistaken, it's open source. You compare the neighboring country, I think Singapore went to lower. Therefore, I suspect that Education not a school, but the industry. That's why I put your question early on, CEO. I feel that many people even talk about sustainability, you tend to swing toward the CSR, or even swing toward the charity. But the content is much, much more than that. Yeah. And I feel strongly that education to the industry is a really priority in order to drive forward for the industry perspective.
It's a very good question. And talking about the definition of sustainability, if you take into account the definition of the United Nations, the OECD, World Economic Forum, it's in fact all about environmental issues, climate change. It's about energy efficiency, the renewables. It's about human rights. It's about the relationship between you as a company and your employees and society. It's about integrity and transparency. It's also about creating jobs for those people who have a handicap, that type of issue. All these components are part of sustainability. And the problem is a bit if you talk about CSR in the traditional sense, it is something extra, giving money to charity, etc. And if you want to be successful in the sphere of sustainability, exactly what you're saying, you must use the right definition. And the question is, how can you integrate sustainability in the core business of your activities? And it can be a company, an institution, an organization, school, university, etc. So it's a matter of clarity about everything. And otherwise, it's not the real story. That's one. The second point is, be open about results. A company like DSM, of course, they are delivering reports every year about their sustainability performance. They also have a paragraph, what went wrong? It's a risky affair, because if you are so open about what went wrong, but I think it was an example of strength for that company, because they're honest about their results. And if you have the right analysis, then you can also make progress. In a time when I was Prime Minister, we worked with the delivery system. That means that you must set your targets for policymaking. So I think we had 78 targets. What do you want to reach? What's your timetable? What are your financial means? And this is really helpful when you talk about the implementation. So every year I could control all the ministers. What are you doing? What's your performance? What went well? What went wrong? That really can be helpful. And if you talk about sustainability, it's also about measurement and reporting, and it's exactly my concern about the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations. You can have beautiful goals, but it is about implementation, about actions, about transparency. So that's what I would like to say after your good remarks, because indeed you must be clear about definitions, actions, implementation, and reporting.
Is there a danger that, you know, if attitudes change faster than change is implemented, that, you know, you start to actually erode? You talked about trust, right? You start to erode trust in some of the institutions and so on that we rely on today, because people demand change and those institutions cannot change fast enough.
Of course, it's not so easy to change from one day into another, that's true. On the other hand, people discover that if you have an honest story, if they're willing to change, you can change things. You can see that among companies. The key issue is there a willingness to reinvent yourself? Let me give two examples. I mentioned the company DSM. Traditionally, it was the state's mines in the Netherlands, coal production. We stopped the debt activity in the 60s. Then it became a chemical company, and now it's about nutrients. So it's constantly it's changing itself. Second example, the Philips company. Traditionally, they made radios, televisions, bulbs, etc. Today, it's about medical equipment, and it's about the circular economy. It has changed completely. What you can see among these companies is that they are changing things, so developing the strategies, they convince the workers that you have to do things in another way. It's also convincing clients that it's good to change. And I think it's possible, but you need clarity. You must have focus. Also be clear about your timetable. And sometimes things can go very rapidly. For example, in the Netherlands, it's good to talk about the consumers. When we have to do with issues around child labor, then the consumers are activists in the Netherlands. People don't accept that. When it's about quality of food, and the same will be here, then of course people are active because you want to have good quality of food. Some tax measures that also lead to another behavior of people rather rapidly. So you can see that. And my point is that so many things are on our agenda. We have to change our behavior. And sometimes you have to be aware of the fact you cannot act alone. What I see in my country is that it really helps if companies are working together with each other and with NGOs and others. It is about a mindset. You cannot expect from one company alone that the company changes everything. That's not possible. But you can make a difference if you're working in the right way, a new alliance, etc.
Gentleman in the middle.
Hi, I'm Jun Xiang from National Parks Board. So you're talking about sustainability. For companies that want to be sustainable, they do need to attract investments and also need to convince their shareholders. And a lot of times, all these are shareholders and investors are from the finance industry. And finance industry, their main aim is to maximize profit. So how do you convince the finance industry to actually finance the sustainability? Thanks.
Yeah, it's a very good question. Have you ever heard about Peter Bucker? He was a former CEO of TNT, that's a logistical company, and now he is the president of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And he exactly elaborates on the same point as you do now. He's concerned about the financial sector, because his analysis is that a lot of companies are changing their business strategies. They're willing to integrate sustainability into their business models. But he said, in fact, the financial sector is too conservative. It doesn't count for all the institutions, but you can see it. Let me give some positive examples. First, the financial institutions like the pension funds. In the Netherlands, we have several pension funds, and they are investing a lot worldwide. More and more, these pension funds are talking about doing sustainable investments. And they talk about the impact of their investments. That's changing. That's one. Among the banks, for example, the Netherlands, we have the Triodos Bank. And that's a bank that's, let's say, a more alternative bank, but they are really involved in doing the right investments that has a sustainability impact. So you have some institutions that already are changing their behavior. Third example, companies like ING, ABN AMRO, and Rabobank in the Netherlands, they're all talking about how can we play our role in the sphere of sustainability. Last year, the ING group had the number one position in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index. And I congratulated the CEO of ING, said there's a great performance, said, oh, but we have to do much more. So there are also other examples. These are the positive elements. But I also see people in the financial sector, they only talk in terms of, the profits are back. We have the same level as in 2008. And then my question would be, what has been your analysis? Because it's not the issue that your profits are on the old level. Because what happened in 2008, of course we have paid a price for that. People who lost their jobs. A lot of states have high state debts at the moment. That's a consequence. So I think it's important also the financial sector shows its creativity and its willingness to work together in the field of sustainability. And if it's only a matter of making profits in the short run, I think then we have to learn from what happened in the past. When we talk about the long-term perspective, and that counts also for, let's say, the private companies, more and more people are talking about long-term aspects and long-term goals. That's also relevant for the financial sector. And I really hope that also the financial sector will be a partner in this whole process. But we're not there, and that was also the reason why Peter Bakker was so critical about the financial sector.
Do we have others with questions for Professor Balkenende?
It's time to have a beer. Heineken, I'll tell you a story about Heineken. That's maybe my last story.
Yes.
Then we can end a bit in a more relaxed way. To me, the following happened. I attended our troops in Afghanistan. Also Singaporeans were there. And I think these military troops are great men and women. They are doing fantastic work in difficult circumstances. And when you've been in Afghanistan, of course, you cannot fly directly from Afghanistan to Amsterdam. You have to stop in one of the Gulf states. And one of these emirs of one of the Gulf states, he offered his hospitality and we could stay in his palace. So that was an honor for us. So we stayed in the palace of that emir. We were there late in the evening. There was a fantastic dinner. We had beautiful rooms. Everything was there, except the thing the prime minister needed mostly, a beer. And in these circumstances, Mr. Ambassador, you have to rely on the quality of our diplomats. So the second man of that embassy, he went to the palace of the emir. And of course, the security people stopped. And they saw a Red Cross box in his car. And security people said, what's that? And the diplomat said, these are the medicines for the prime minister. And then he came to me and he opened the Red Cross box and it was filled with cans of Heineken. That was a good diplomat. Thank you very much.
On behalf of all of us here, may I propose that we show our appreciation in the usual way.
Thank you, Professor Balkenende and Mr. Lee, for sharing your insights and experiences on cities, governance, and sustainability. We'd now like to invite Mr. Koo, Executive Director of CLC, on stage to present tokens of appreciation to our speaker and moderator, followed by a group photo. Mr. Koo, please.
New York, but I'm sure if she isn't done, I want to see the camera.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our lecture. Thank you for your participation. We have quite a few lectures lined up for October, so do stay tuned to CLC mailers or visit our website for registration. We'll be seeking your feedback via email and would greatly appreciate if you could take the time to help us improve the CLC lecture series. Have a good evening and we hope to see you again. Thank you.